Hello students, we are again here to extend our chapter production and cost further, which we were doing in our last lecture. As you must know that we were discussing the laws of returns to scale applicable in the long run. These laws state the behavior of change in output when all factors are increased in the same proportion. This long run law is divided into three stages. First stage is increasing returns to scale, means that the percentage increase in the total output is more than the percentage increase in all the factor inputs. For example, if the labor and capital are increased by 50% and the total product increases by 70%, it is said that law of increasing returns to scale is operating. Second stage is constant returns to scale, means that the percentage increase in total output is exactly equal to the percentage increase in all the factor inputs employed in the same proportion. For example, if the labor and capital are increased by 50% and the total product also increases by 50%, the law of constant returns to scale is said to operate. Third stage is diminishing returns to scale, means that the percentage increase in total product is less than the percentage increase in the factor inputs. For example, if the labor and capital is increased by 50%, but the total product increases by 40% only, the law of diminishing returns to scale is said to operate. Now, the question which is arising in our mind is that why law of returns to scale operate? Or why it happens that initially output increases at increasing rate, then at constant rate, and finally at decreasing rate? The reason behind this logic is economies and diseconomies of scale. Students, economies of scale means benefits derived by expanding the scale of business, due to which there is a reduction in per unit cost of production. On the other hand, diseconomies of scale means demerits, means beyond its optimum capacity, its per unit cost of production rises. Actually, both economies and diseconomies are of two types, internal economies and diseconomies, and external economies and diseconomies. First, we will discuss the economies of scale. Let's start with internal economies of scale. Internal economies accrue to the individual firm, means each firm can effect reduction in its cost of production by expanding its scale of production to the optimum point. These economies do not reach to the whole industry. Types of internal economies, it may be technical economies. This type of economies arises due to the use of better plant, machinery, equipment and better techniques of production. Due to technical economies, cost per unit falls because introduction of superior technique increases the aggregate output. Secondly, high cost of machines can be easily spread over a large output, thus reducing the per unit cost. Avoiding dependence on other firms and suppliers for raw material. A firm in the long run develops its own sources of raw material, means of transportation, distribution system, etc. A firm in long run can avoid all kinds of wastages and makes proper utilization of waste material to produce byproducts. For example, a sugar mill can install a straw board plant to make use of the sugarcane pulp left over after manufacturing sugar. A large firm may reap the technical economies of increased dimensions. For example, it may be economical to ply double-decker buses as compared to single-decker buses. Because with the same conductor, same driver, same fuel, etc., a firm can earn double. So, these all were the internal technical economies of scale. Now, the second internal economies of scale is managerial economies. In a small unit, the owner has to look after all the managerial functions. And as we know that a single person cannot fulfill all the managerial responsibilities effectively and efficiently. A large firm or a firm in long run can delegate the functional responsibilities to the business executives of high skill and qualifications to look after the different departments, such as production, finance, administration, sales, advertisement, etc. This functional specialization of business personnel increases the productive efficiency of the firm, thus lowering the per unit cost of production. Third, internal economy is financial economies. A firm in long run gets the advantage of financial economies while raising the capital. The firm can raise capital by issuing shares, debentures, and inviting public deposits. The cost of raising capital through public issues is very low. A small unit, on the other hand, cannot issue shares and debentures. It has to depend on money lenders who charge a very high rate of interest. Fourth, internal economy is in the nature of marketing economies. The benefits under marketing economies are bulk purchase of raw material. Therefore, a large sized firm gets priority over the small producer in the purchase of raw material. Due to bulk purchase, large firm also enjoys regular supply of raw material and heavy rate of discount, thus lowering the cost. Transport companies also prefer to look for a large firm because they get the regular supply of raw material and finished products. A large firm can also engage highly qualified experts to look after sales promotion. Not only this, a large firm can afford to grant various concessions to wholesalers and retail dealers and customers also, and thus captures large market for its product. The last but not the least internal economies of scale is risk and survival economies. Actually, a large firm is in better position to face the risk of uncertainties. As a large firm produces a variety of goods, like Parle produces biscuits, fruitcakes, toffees, chocolates, etc. Even if there is a fall in the demand for a particular product, the firm can still survive because it can continue to produce other goods. Losses in one unit could be made good by generating surplus in other units. Not only this, a large firm can undertake research to develop new products, new sources of energy, new technology, etc. This research and development enables a firm to economize the cost of production. Students, these were the internal economies of scale. Now, the turn is of external economies. External economies are not related to a particular firm. Rather, these are the benefits which are shared by all the manufacturing units. Whenever an area is developed, certain benefits accrue which are common to all firms in that area, like transport facilities are provided, like roads, railways are built. Commercial services of all kinds are available, as banking, warehousing, insurance, etc. Manufacturers are able to discuss their problems of their mutual interest. Subsidiary industries spring up in the neighborhood, supplying accessories and parts or making use of waste matter by giving it the shape of byproducts. All these advantages are shared by each of the firm in an industry. They find their cost per unit going down. Here ends the economies of scale, both internal and external. Now we will throw some light on the diseconomies of scale or reasons responsible for the rising per unit cost of production. There is a point of optimum capacity for all the firms and industries. If any firm grows beyond its scale of optimum capacity, it shall regret to find that additional units are being produced only at a higher cost. we can say that beyond the point of optimum capacity, a firm attracts diseconomies of scale. The diseconomies of scale may again be of two types, internal diseconomies and external diseconomies. Diseconomies are like beyond a point, a firm may be compelled to pay more wages if it wants to attract more labor. Likewise, heavy concentration in an area may lead to frequent traffic jams, etc. These diseconomies may be associated with the difficulties of managing and controlling an enterprise as its size increases. For a large sized firm, planning and coordination at different levels of decision making becomes a serious problem. Employment of large number of workers also causes problem of proper supervision. In this way, we can analyze that due to economies, whether internal or external, the cost per unit of production falls, and due to diseconomies of scale, whether internal or external, cost per unit of production rises. So, till here, it all was about production. Now, we will understand the concept of cost. Ordinarily, the term cost of production refers to the money expenses incurred in the production of a commodity. But there may be some other costs which are not monetary in nature but are a part of cost of production as depreciation. Now, what is cost function? If you remember, the production function is the relationship between physical input and output. In the same way, cost function expresses the relationship between cost and its determinants. It means cost function is a financial relationship between cost and its various determinants. There are several factors which influence cost. Symbolically, cost function can be expressed as C equals to function of S O P T, where C is cost, S is size of plant, O is level of output, P is prices, and T is technology. All these are several factors on which cost of a product depends. This cost function may be formulated for short run and long run depending upon the requirements of the firm. But remember, short run and long run functions are interrelated. They are interdependent. First, we will do short run cost function. Basically, there are some factors which can be easily adjusted with changes in the level of output, like labor and raw material can be used more if a firm has to expand its production. Such factors are known as variable factors. On the other hand, there are some factors such as land, capital equipment, which cannot be easily varied. It requires comparatively longer time to make changes in them. Such factors are called as fixed factors. On the basis of this variable factor and fixed factor, we distinguish between short run and long run period of time. Short run is a period of time in which output can be increased or decreased by changing only the amount of variable factors. If the firm wants to increase the output in the short run, it can do so only with the help of variable factors. On the other hand, long run is a period of time in which the quantities of all factors are variable, means there is no factor fixed in the long run. Students, we will keep our today's lecture till here. Let's revise what we have done today. Today, we discussed the topics economies and diseconomies of scale, both internal and external. Also, we discussed that in the long run, these economies and diseconomies are responsible for the increasing and decreasing per unit cost of the production. Then we started the concept of cost with the cost function and also discussed the meaning of short run and long run period of time. In our next lecture, we will do the rest of the portion of this chapter with types of cost function. Till then, thank you.